Sunday Morning on BBC Radio Scotland.
Welcome to Sunday Morning with me, Zara Janjua. Now, between now and 10 o'clock, I'll be celebrating the joys of Glastonbury with the Iona community, who've been providing a haven of peace and tranquility for festival goers for well over a decade. I'll also be chatting to Scotland's Macker, Kathleen Jamie, about her new poetry collection, and to author Amanda Scott about her journey into shamanism. Plus, after nine, I'll be joined by a panel of regulars to chat through some of the conversations in the ether this week, including Julian Assange and the new ITV show Douglas is Cancelled. But first, some music. Stevie Nicks will be performing. Scotland's Macker, Kathleen Jamie, is a poet whose work often breaks the boundaries of what we might consider poetry. She's a writer of essays, microprose, and even shorter pieces which feel like wry one-liners. Her tenure as Scotland's national poet has seen her use many of her writing talents, penning verse on a variety of topics that reflect Scottish public life. But for her new collection, Cairn, she's looked back on her own past and also the deep past of rocks and landscapes and the natural world around us. I'm very pleased to say that Kathleen Jamie joins me now to tell us a little bit more about her new book. Hello, good morning and welcome, Kathleen.
Good morning. Lovely to be here.
It's very lovely to have you with us this morning. Now, I want to ask Cairn, as many hillwalkers will probably know, it's that mound of stones that we see at the top of a mountain or on a hill. Why did you choose this as the title for your new collection?
Well, it's a book of very short pieces, not poetry, prose, non-fiction. Some are only a page long, some are a couple of pages long. And after I'd written quite a few of them, I thought, you know, what is this? Because I never know what I'm writing until it's done. But what is this? And I realised it was, as you say, a cutting at a time of life when I was looking at the landscape of my own past and the landscapes of my own future, and also at this strange moment that we're all living in, this peculiar juncture. And I thought, oh, it's like a cairn, you know, yeah. it's a way marker and it's a viewpoint and it's a memorial site. So cairn became the image of the book.
I mean, you mentioned there that you were looking back on your own past and the past of the natural world. What sort of prompted that at the time for you?
I was turning 60 and simultaneously remembering turning 30. You know, and the differences between those two occasions, especially in my relationship with the natural world. I think 30 years ago was the last time we could credibly say that everything would be all right, you know, and nature was in trouble, but it would restore itself because it's bigger than we are. And the subsequent 30 years have seen that attitude no longer become quite possible as it was. Mm-hmm. And now we have to acknowledge it's in trouble and we have to, you know, do something about it.
And were there parallels that you were drawing on that and in your own life at 60?
Just at 60, you have the sense that, of course, your life is finite, you know, the way you don't have when you're young, or you shouldn't have. But you can definitely, I can definitely sense the shape of that.
Yeah.
Now, you know, barring accidents, I can sense that this shape of that arc, if you like, which is part of the greater natural cycles, of course. I have no worries about that. But the very fact that those natural cycles that we used to be able to map our own lives against, if they are breaking down, then we're in trouble.
I want to talk more about these shapes because I feel like it's a very important part of your book, Cairn. And, you know, you open with this collection, you open the collection with a prologue and an epilogue and which looks back on a life. And you can clearly see, you know, the shape of that. But mm-hmm. also life moves around in spirals. You know, how then has writing this collection coincided with those moments of spiralling or shape-seeing?
I've always been interested in time from when I was a teenager and discovered that there were archaeological remains actually within cycling distance of our house. You know, I thought, oh, wow, mm-hmm. this is here 5,000 years ago.
Wow.
That sort of depth of time, deep time, the fact that the planet's been here for, you know, billions of years, everything will change in ways that we cannot imagine. I've always been fascinated by those ideas and to have one's own life in a microcosm. I have this notion that time is not just an arrow going straight forward, but that it does spiral around.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you can feel in your own life closer to an event of 30 years ago than to an event that happened yesterday. It has a sort of, I can't describe it, a proximity.
Yeah. You write, obviously, a lot about the natural world, and you clearly have a connection to that natural world. Scottish landmarks are in here, including the Bass Rock, Scapa Flow, Glen Esk. You know, in what way would you say your relationship and permanence and the power of nature has changed?
Well, just that. I think 30 years ago, it was possible to be quite blithe about it. And nature was lovely and out there and restorative and could offer us consolations, you know, and then subsequent 30 years, that's no longer the case. It still does, of course, mm-hmm. find moments of absolute joy and wonder. You know, seeing a humpback whale on the 4th of 4th was something
oh, wow.
I never thought would happen, you know.
We're always very envious when we see those news reports and think, gosh, we wish we'd been there to actually witness them firsthand. But it's spending time in nature, isn't it?
Well, you can just dash up to Burnt Island on the train and be there. You know, it's amazing. You don't have to go out into the wild remotes.
No, of course. And you're going to read a poem for us from the collection called The Night Wind. Can you just introduce it for us and then read it in your own time?
Well, this is one of the very few actual poems in the book, because it varies from short essays to little poems like this. The Night Wind. Asleep with the window open, dreaming you lie awake. The night breeze slips over the sill, sails your room like a lake, and sweeps you up, a voyager exhilarated with youth, then drops you, whispering the unconsoling truth. You're dead, stay dead. Alive are sky and ocean and land. Bear in mind, though I'm leaving you cast up on daybreak's strand, I'll be back ere long to scatter you. Till then, let sunshine bathe your skin. There's more days past than ahead of you. Now you can begin.
Oh, Kathleen, thank you so much. You paint so many pictures with your words. It's a very beautiful poem. And, you know, you've given us a little taste there of what to expect. I wanted to dive a little bit more into the collection and talk to you about, you know, your references to growing storms, and as you've mentioned a little bit about climate change there in particular, those changes in nature that you've been seeing. One of your pieces, June, you know, it sees you and your siblings clearing out your late parents' house, and you're kind of talking about the threat of wildfires that perhaps didn't exist when you were younger. Are you conscious then, as a poet, do you want to use your platform to communicate the urgency of a climate crisis?
Well, yes and no. I'm a writer, not an activist.
Yeah.
And I find I can draw a very distinct, distinction between those two things. But at the same time, my writing is, you can't tell fibs, you know? You can't pretend everything's well. And in one's writing, you have to go there,
mm-hmm.
else it would be a lie. So it's acts of bearing witness, I think, and being frank and telling it as it is. I think those are also, and noticing, crucially, I think those are actions that the writers and artists can and should take, you know.
And then,
if that's activism, well and good.
It's interesting to talk about process with any writer that we've had on. It's always interesting to get an insight. And you'd mentioned earlier that you often begin writing and you don't know what that's going to be. You obviously have a mix of styles. So, you know, at what stage do you decide, you know, if you don't necessarily begin with the intention of it being prose or poem, or, you know, how does it emerge itself to you?
Oh, you know, if I knew that, I could jump a few of the stages. You know, you just sort of feel it. You know, I start writing, I tend to have to sidle up on it.
Yeah.
And it's a wee bit fugitive, so I'll get a bit of scrappy paper and just, without quite looking at it, you know, write down a few things, and then afterwards go, right, okay, what is this worth developing? What is this? What do you want to be? Because you're asking the thing itself what it wants to be. You know, where do you want to go? So you're in a relationship with this new work, and it eventually will tell you, you know, I want to be this, I want to be that. But it's a mysterious process, and it's really enjoyable.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting hearing you describe it as a relationship with the work. I wonder what you get from that keeps you going, because you have created an incredible amount of work over your career so far.
It's just interesting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the day it stops being really interesting is the day I'll quit. But that relationship with the page and with the piece of work, you know, I have absolutely no sense of writing for a reader. You know, a reader has got no place in that initial working out. And that intense lover's relationship with what's on the page, that's what you keep going back to.
And what is it that's sort of inspiring you at the moment? Do you think you're going to continue being inspired by the natural world? Or is there something else that you have your sights set on?
Well, one never does. Because I've just published a book, I mean, I'm flatlining. You know, and it can be a couple of years of nothing, complete silence, by which time you just might give up, you know, before you get that inkling again. So I couldn't possibly say the thing is, you just have to try and remain open to all possibilities. And once you start defining yourself, you know, I only do that sort of writing, or I'm a nature writer, or I'm, you know, something else might be winging its way past you unseen. But I'm fully expecting to be quiet for the next couple of years.
Well, I hope over the next couple of years you get out into nature and that there's plenty of humpback whales to see over in Fife and that you manage to enjoy all of that. Kathy and Jamie, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's been great to have you with us.
My pleasure.
Thank you. And Kathleen's new collection, Cairn, is out now, published by Sort of Books. And what better excuse to play this tune of the same name from the multi...
We'll be right back. London. We broadcast everywhere. We love you wherever you are. We really do not care. In Canada, Australia, and Scotland or Penzance. We love all of our listeners. Yes, even those in France.
It's 8:25 a.m. and you're listening to Sunday Morning with me, Zara Janjua. Now, if you have been anywhere near your TV or radio this weekend, you'll know that, of course, Glastonbury Festival is in full swing. While the annual event is famously full of sound and colour, well, one small corner of the site remains an oasis of peace and calm thanks to the Iona community. The ecumenical Christian movement have been providing a safe and comfortable haven for festival goers at Glastonbury for many, many years. And I'm very pleased to say that two members of the community are joining me now live from the site. We have Susanna Knuckles, who's a team leader at the site, and David Adams, who is a member from Elgin. A very good morning to both of you. Thank you very much for joining.
Good morning.
It's lovely to have you with us, and I'm so sorry to have you up this early. You must be in the middle of a campsite, I can imagine, that was up very late last night with lots of music.
Yes, and we had lots of people into the area, so we didn't close until about 2 o'clock.
Wow. Well, thank you very much for being up this early on a Sunday. Now, David, I believe that it's your very first Glastonbury experience. How have you been finding it so far?
It's a vast area. There are a lot of things happening. It's almost overwhelming sometimes. And I think really you would have to come for a few years to explore everything that this amazing site has to offer.
Well, hopefully you've got some comfortable welly boots on to get you around the site, David. I hope so. Suzanne, you're a team leader at the site, and now we mentioned that the Iona community has been there a long time. There's this very rich history with Glastonbury Festival. Can you just give us a bit of background and tell us how that all came to be?
Well, it began in the 1990s, and at that point, the little area that we're in was basically thicket with a fence round. And we're very close to the dance area, the nightclub area. And because it was kind of dark and unseen, all sorts of things happened at Glastonbury, but some quite unsavoury things were happening in this corner. And so the story goes that the traders and other people got their heads together and thought, well, this space needs to be used differently. Mm-hmm. Local people knew local people. They knew the local group, the Iona group. And we were invited in, and we cleared it, we built steps, we made a kind of beautiful dell and a bit of a calm in the crazy. And they've been here for a long while. Not me personally, but the Iona community and various lovely people have staffed this area over a number of years.
Oh, no, David, Suzanne just mentioned there that you're sandwiched between dance tents. Does it ever feel like a bit of a culture clash with you as a place of peace and contemplation amid that sort of bedlam and noise?
Well, the noise does bleed in, and sometimes, especially late at night, you have to get very close to people to have a conversation mm-hmm. with them because the beats are coming through the hedge. But no, I don't think it affects it. People, the responses we've had from people make it clear that they really welcome the peace and quiet, particularly in the evening with the campfire going. That draws them in, and everyone that has come in has welcomed that moment of calm. And there is always sound here. There is always noise. So it's nice for them just to be able to sit quietly for a while.
Yes, I do have some experience at music festivals, and it feels like there's never any quiet. So it's lovely to imagine you both there offering a bit of peace and tranquility. Suzanne, what is it specifically that you offer? We're saying it's peace and tranquility, but are you holding prayer meetings? Are there weddings or baptisms?
No, it's much more about just very basic stuff about connection. So we offer hospitality of a place, our little dell or little glade in Glastonbury, and then really the team we bob about, we talk to people, we introduce ourselves, we let them introduce themselves to us, And we just see where the conversation goes.
Mm-hmm.
Some people, they're just wanting peace and quiet, and we leave them alone. Some people want, they come on their own sometimes. A lot of people come to Glastonbury on their own. Sometimes they've fallen out with their mates, or they've got an issue or whatever. And the stuff that happens in everyday life, the troubles of everyday life, and it's a bit like the sound, that bleeds into Glastonbury as well.
Yeah.
And we just come alongside. A lot of us have listening skills from sort of Christian ministry backgrounds, and we offer those as well as where we are.
So people want to talk about all sorts of things. You know, it could be that, as you mentioned, they've fallen out with friends, or, you know, they are just looking to for maybe a little bit of company amidst all the strangers. But what kind of people are you engaging with? Do you find it's mostly people from a religious background or a Christian background, David?
No, some do. An amazing number of people do actually know about Iona and the community, and they come in because they've heard about it. They come in, of course, if they've been in years gone by, they come in. But no, absolutely, everybody comes in from all walks of life, mm-hmm. and some are very curious. Some are just happy just to sit for a while and talk.
How lovely. Now, obviously, you're there with purpose, but I need to ask you both, have you had the chance at all to enjoy any of the festival itself? Have you been to see any of the bands and acts? Maybe Suzanne first.
Well, I organise the rota, so...
So you schedule yourself in for all the good ones?
Well, I've not kind of skewed the rota in any way to suit myself. but I make sure that the team have time off.
Great.
To listen intently is quite exhausting, actually. So we do go. I've been to see... I mean, I was there at Coldplay last night with my wristband.
Their fifth time, I believe, headlining.
To fix you.
Oh, great. And what about you, David? Have there been any highlights for you?
Yes. I mean, mostly bands from my younger days, Squeeze and Haircut 100. But I did enjoy Little Sims last night on the main stage as well.
Oh, yeah. Brilliant.
Seen some great things.
Yeah, I think David's the cool one.
Well, it sounds like you're both making the most of the experience, and it's lovely to know that we have you there. There could be many listeners today tuning in from Glastonbury that might come along and see you. So it'll be great to hear from you again. I hope that you enjoy your time in Glastonbury, enjoy the music festival, and enjoy the conversations you're having with everyone. Thank you so much for being with us this morning, Suzanne Knuckles and David Adam of the Iona community. Yeah, definitely make the most of that festival. Now, let's have a blast now of this Scottish legend who brought the party to Glastonbury on Friday night. was a bit joyful, wasn't it? Lulu there, one of the many Scottish artists at this year's Glastonbury. The party isn't over yet, and there will be coverage today on TV and radio, as well as on BBC iPlayer and, of course, at BBC Sounds, where you'll also be able to catch up on anything you have missed. Now, you're listening to Sunday Morning with me, Zara Janjua, and coming up at 10, both here on BBC Radio Scotland and on BBC One Scotland, is The Sunday Show with Martin Geisler and Fiona Stewart. And Fiona joins me now to share what's coming up. A very good morning to you, Fiona.
Good morning, Zara. Fiona Stalker, but there we go. That's okay. No problem at all. Now, can you believe this is the last Sunday morning before polling day? 4 days to go. We'll be chewing over the polls with Elsa Henderson from Edinburgh University. In the last of our leader interviews, Martin will be speaking to the SNP's John Swinney, and we have assembled a star panel of former politicians to talk us through the Sunday papers. Our guest this week, Jean Freeman, of course, the former SNP MSP who served as Health Secretary until 2021. Peter Duncan, one-time Scottish Conservative MP and shadow Scottish Secretary. Peter's now working in PR. Jim Murphy became a Labour MP in 1997. He went on to become Scottish Secretary in the late 2000s and later leader of Scottish Labour. He now works in strategic communications. And Siobhan Mathers, who works with the think tank Reform Scotland. She was once a candidate and vice convener of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. All that and much more on the Sunday Show with me, Fiona Stalker, and Martin Geisler on BBC Radio Scotland and, of course, on BBC One Scotland from 10 o'clock. Speak to you then.
Lovely, Fiona. So much coming up on the programme. And, of course, Fiona Stalker is such a legend. How could I not know? Of course, of course. Now, my spiritual life guest this week is the Sunday Times best-selling author of mythic historical thriller series Boudicca and 2018 standalone critically acclaimed A Treachery of Spies, Manda Scott. Now, of course, Manda has been shortlisted for the Orange Prize and Edgar and the Saltire Award and is host of the Accidental Gods podcast focused on crafting a route through to a future we'd be proud to leave behind. But writing and podcasting are not her only vocations in life. Manda has worked as a veterinarian anaesthetist, trained in homeopathy, and is currently practicing eco-spiritual shamanic. So she is clearly somewhat of a polymath. Well, now Manda has written a new book called Any Human Power, a visionary new fantasy thriller about a family at the centre of a global uprising. Manda, thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation.
It's really great to have you with us. Now, I have to ask, we've heard of utopian, we've heard of dystopian, but you describe your new book, Any Human Power, as a throughtopian fiction for the cli-fi generation. So what does that actually mean?
Yeah, I don't think it's a fantasy. That's kind of interesting. So throughtopias are the middle ground. Dystopias show us how bad things could be if we get the worst of humanity moving forward. Utopias tend to be really nice, unicorns skipping through the daisies, but you can't see how to get there. So a throughtopia takes us from exactly where we are through to a future that would actually work. My aim in writing it, in doing Accidental Gods and all the rest, is that we create a future where seven generations down the line, they look back at us and they say that we were good ancestors. You know, we left it too late and we got a lot of stuff wrong. But in the end, when it really mattered, we all got together, we coalesced around a common set of values, and we laid the foundations for a future where our descendants, however far they go, are thriving as an integral part of a living planet. There is flourishing. There is what they need to build good, decent, integrated lives. And I don't think we're on the track to do that just now, but I think that it's still possible to swerve the bus from the edge of the cliff. So the throughtopia is what starts here now, and walks us through in ways that everybody can see they could do, and takes us to something that we would all really want to get to.
Now, that's obviously the premise, but what, I wonder if you could tell us a bit more about the plot itself. So it's obviously told from the perspective of a protagonist who dies in the first chapter, and I hope there's no spoiler alerts in saying
No, it's on the back cover. If it's a spoiler, people are really not paying attention. So it grew out of my shamanic practice. I had a set of visions, and that particular scene where Lan, who's roughly my age, is lying on a bed and her 15-year-old son is at her bedside, and he says, when you come home, can we go up the hill and watch the crows go to bed? Because I work with crows. And she says, no, I'm not coming home. This is it. You know, I'm dying. There is no coming home from here. We have talked about this. And in the ensuing conversation, he says, you're the only one that gets me. I don't want to live in a world with you not in it. And she realises he's saying what he believes to be true. And she says, I don't know what happens next, but if you really need me and you call, if it's possible, I will come. And she and he and we all feel the gods pause in their labour, look down and go, okay, that was a promise. You are held to that. And then she dies. And then she is caught in the between place between the lands of life and the lands of death, having to fulfil that promise. And the core of the thriller, I'm calling this a mythopolitical thriller because that really fills what I think we're doing. So the core is that her granddaughter, who's conceived on the night of her funeral, 14 years later, sends a tweet that around which a global uprising, primarily youth, but this is intergenerational really, arises. And they want change. They've looked at the existing establishment that is selling their futures in real time for, you know, yet another sack of gold. And they want something that's going to work. They want the future that I think is possible. And then there's a short space of time where everybody goes, yeah, you're right. And then it all falls apart and the establishment begins to fight back and it fights dirty. So the thriller component, the thriller arc is, how do you establish trust? Change happens at the speed of trust. How do you establish it when you know that you need to build a global community, a global movement, and the establishment will be seeding people in who are trying to destroy you? How do you overturn the sclerotic political system that we have within the rules and peacefully? Because I absolutely, totally think if we're going to shift paradigm, the use of violence to solve problems is old paradigm. We need to be new paradigm. How do you move forward with a new set of values in a way that feels coherent? Did that make sense?
I mean, there is, of course it did. And there's such deep thought involved in what you write. It's fascinating to get an insight into your imagination and those really big questions that have formulated the premise of this. And it very much seems to have started with that question. You know, when you look at any human power, that's also, that's set in this sort of near future, which is quite different from your series Boudicca, which was set in this sort of Roman invasion of Britain era. Yes. They're both very compelling, vivid worlds. But how, for you, did it compare writing about a sort of, well, an ancient time informed by historical events versus writing about a time or place that, that actually doesn't exist?
Doesn't exist yet. It was considerably harder. I thought writing historical stuff was quite hard because you have to get your head around everything that we know and then everything we could know. But this is, this, if I hadn't been running the podcast for the last 4 years, I would have had no clue. Uh-huh. The point of the book, though, is that everything in there, there's one boat that I kind of put together from other parts, but it could exist. Everything in there is being done somewhere in the world. All I did was bring them all together in an overarching narrative. But it was really hard because we're trying to create total systemic change. Tweaking the edges of predatory capitalism is not going to do it anymore. We need a new value system. We need to predicate everything on being and belonging instead of separation and scarcity and powerlessness. And doing that, I think writing utopias where you've got the jump cut is easier than here. We're in the mess of now. How do we step forward to something that's actually going to be worth going for, that everybody will go, yeah, I want that. It's not going to be easy. No one's pretending it's easy. It's not going to necessarily be simple, but it is possible. How do we get the momentum behind that? So if I hadn't done the podcast, not a chance.
Interesting. I mean, it's interesting how everything you do, I guess, in a sense, will inspire other work, because as we mentioned, you do so much. But I wondered if this, if there's an element of activism through your writing. Is there something that you're, are you trying to incite change?
Yes, of course. Yeah. Yes. But there always has been. To be honest, everything I've ever written has had some kind of activist base. But yeah, this is nakedly, absolutely, 100%. I seriously think we're going over the edge of the cliff. We're in the middle of the sixth mass extinction. If we don't turn the bus, then our descendants are either not going to exist at all, or they're going to have a very, very rough life compared to what we have now. But I genuinely think, on a spiritual basis, that we're getting a lot of help, and that that wouldn't happen if the bus going over the edge of the cliff was inevitable. And so I feel I've got a moral and an ethical and a spiritual duty to do whatever I can to help people understand that there is alternative. We have the narrative of there is no alternative. It's easier to imagine the end of all life on earth than it is to imagine the end of capitalism. But that's just because our imaginations are constrained. So what I'm trying to do is open doors so that people can walk through and see the amazing creativity of humanity. What happens if we bring our focus to bear on the hyper-complex emergent process that we are, instead of just, you know, we're all born to pay bills and die, which is plainly not true, and we all know it's not true, but we're not given obvious alternatives. So here, doors open, let's go.
Mm. I'm interested to know how you found yourself writing. What was it that sort of inspired you into this? Was it a quest to make a difference, or was it something far more personal?
Yeah, as I said, I thought I'd given up writing. I was doing the podcast, and, you know, exactly as we're doing, we could do a podcast live. I don't, because it's scary, but I could. And so you can get ideas out in pretty much real time. A book takes a long time. I started writing it at the summer solstice 2021. Goodness. Because I'd had a series of shamanic visions while I was teaching, mm-hmm. which isn't what usually happens, but... And they were really precise, and I can tell you if you want, but I'm not sure I can do it really tightly, but they were really clear. And my experience with that is that you don't ignore anything, but sometimes it takes a while to unpick the nudges. And this wasn't nudges, this was 100% clear text, do this. And I did this, which involved going to sit up the hill for an hour at dusk every day, wow. watching the sun go to bed, basically. And by the end of that week, I had the first scene and the premise of the novel. And then the instruction was, now you write this. Because I'd been coasting in my writing for a good 3 years. And thought the podcast was going to be it. But then the absolute clear instruction was, whatever else you do, you have to write this novel.
Well, we'd love to dive more into the shamanic practices, and we will do very shortly. But before then, we'd love to play your chosen track. It's Thank We you. Shall Be Known by Mamuse. So can you tell us why you've chosen this?
Yeah, I don't really do music, which my neurodivergent diagnosed friends tell me is a real sign of absolute neurodivergence. But music, canned music, I can't do it at all. Live music I can do. And this is a track that we sing quite a lot in the shamanic ceremony for reasons that I think will become obvious when you hear it. So I think it's an astonishing call to connection.
We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. Turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the world.
bleed in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love.
Beautiful. That was We Shall Be Known by Mamuse, chosen by this week's This Spiritual Life guest, Sunday Times bestselling author Manda Scott. Now, Manda, you've had such a varied career, and I'd love to know more about your early life and upbringing, because you grew up in Eaglesham, which was just in this small village near East Kilbride, and you have previously described it as a Presbyterian enclave, as well as your mother ran a rehabilitation centre for birds of prey. What was life like for you growing up?
Different, I guess. And I am incredibly grateful for that, because what I learned above all else was that it was okay not to fit in. And then continued not to fit in for the rest of my life, really. So, yeah, Eaglesham's lovely. I adore it. And it's really old, and it's built in the centre of Eaglesham's built in the shape of an A, because it was the seat of the Earls of Alexander, I think. Earls. Anyway. Somebody who had a lot of money called Alexander, who then created a village with his own initial, which was pretty cool, I think, back in the day. And the Covenanter's Hill was up above the village, and we all learned about that kind of thing. Yeah, I grew up in the 60s and the 70s. It was a very, very different world back then. And yes, my mother ran a rehab centre for birds of prey. So one of my strongest memories is there was a very, very big box in the kitchen. And at dawn and dusk, we would swap the tawny owls for the kestrels. So the kestrels came out in the daytime, tawny owls came out at night. And there was this kind of chaotic moment at dawn and dusk as we swapped them over. And undoubtedly, that's how I ended up training in veterinary medicine, because what else would you do when you're surrounded by small living things that need help? So it was good. It was fine. And it let me be different.
Well, most of us spend our childhood wanting to be the same as everyone else. And I think that those differences are perhaps something that we can only appreciate maybe once we are older. But it sounds like you very quickly were able to accept and enjoy and embrace that. What else about your environment sort of shaped your view of religion?
I think there was a very defining moment when I was, I think, probably about nine. I'd read Rosemary Sutcliffe's Eagle of the Ninth, which your older listeners will remember, and it was really formative. I read it again. I wrote a book called Eagle of the Twelfth, and I reread Eagle of the Ninth and just realised how colonial and misogynist it was. But at the age of nine, I just completely didn't know that, and I was enthralled because young Marcus, who's a good Roman lad whose dad has been disgraced because the Ninth has lost its eagle, he comes north of the wall, so he's come into Scotland, yay, hunting the eagle, and he ends up with the seal people somewhere on the west coast, undefined place where there's lots of sea. And the priests of the horned moon god have definitely got the eagle, and they're definitely not going to give it to him willingly. And they go into their sacred place, which is kind of a long barrow, and it's got this goatskin curtain on the door. And they go in, and you know they are talking to their gods. And you have no idea. Rosemary Sutcliffe, in none of her books, because I read the lot soon after that, never describes how they talk to their gods. But I completely, that was my first real indication that was possible, that something that I knew I yearned to do had been done and therefore could be done again. And then my dad took us to the Brochs, and that was like, okay, now I'm here. Now these are the people, these are my people. I just need to learn to talk to the gods of this land in a way that is going to make sense to them and to me. And the whole of the rest of my life has been predicated on that question. How do I do that best? How do I do it most cleanly? This is why I ended up writing the Boudicca books and then ended up teaching this. So everything that I do arises from reading that book and then that experience.
And can you just briefly explain to us what shamanism is?
It's the indigenous original spirituality of humanity. So for however long, 3 million years, 300,000 years, 64 million years since the last mass extinction, however long you think we have been evolving as conscious nodes in the overall web of life, shamanic practice is the understanding that we are conscious nodes in the web of life. It's the connectedness. It's the knowing that we are not separate and the spiritual path of enhancing that connection. One of my old teachers said, consensus reality that our Western world knows of as reality is a tiny part of all possible reality, and that with training, the shamanic practitioner can step out in order to ask for help, go into all of the other potential realities to ask for help. And that's, I would say, one part of it. But for me, the big part is we are an integral part of the web of life. It's only our culture. What Francis Weller makes a distinction between the initiation cultures, whose spirituality is shamanic, and the trauma culture, mm-hmm. which is our culture, where we believe ourselves to be separate. Mm-hmm. And so it's an undoing of that separation, a healing of that trauma, in order to ask the web, what do you want me to do at every moment, and have the groundedness to listen and respond in real time.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you did mention that you often go and you were watching the sunset. Were you watching the sun rise this morning? Is watching that those kind of natural cycles part of the practice?
Not necessarily this morning, because it's usually rising down here at about quarter to five. Yeah. But you know, on the cross days and the quarter days, I will be. So at the solstice, I would be, and the equinoxes and the marriage points in between, I would definitely be doing that. Yes,
you would. Well, I mean, it sounds like a very beautiful practice, and it's been lovely to hear your insights into shamanism, but also your insights into your own life and how you came to this successful writing career and everything else you do. Manda Scott, thank you so much for that. It was a really beautiful insight and discussion, and about your new book as well, Any Human Power, which is, of course, out now. Coming up after nine, I'll be joined by Rabbi Pete Tobias of the Glasgow Reform Synagogue, writer, anti-racism facilitator and activist Brianna Pigado, and Stuart Kelly, a writer and Church of Scotland elder. We'll be taking a dive into the world of whistleblowing following the news this week that Julian Assange has been freed to return to his native Australia, as well as how faith interacts with cancel culture and what the Ten Commandments mean in a modern world. On the way, the news, and taking us there, Billy Ocean, Love Really Hurts Without You.
Digital Radio. FM. Your smart speaker.
including Rabbi Pete Tobias of the Glasgow Reformed Synagogue, Rihanna Pegado, a writer of anti-racism facilitator and activist, and Stuart Kelly, a writer and Church of Scotland elder. Hello, good morning. How are you?
Good morning.
Morning.
Lovely
morning,
to have you with us. We'll be delving into the world of whistleblowing. We'll be chatting about the Ten Commandments after the news that Louisiana has passed legislation requiring the Ten Commandments be displayed in all classrooms. And my panel have had the chance to watch the new ITV series Douglas is Cancelled, starring Hugh Bonneville and Karen Gillan. So we'll be getting into all of that in a moment, but let's get some music first. This is the very time.
I left a note on his dresser. My old wedding ring with these few goodbye words. How can I sing goodbye, old sleepy head? I'm packing you in like I said. Take care of everything. I'm leaving my wedding ring. Don't look for me.
Afternoon film, and you haven't seen Lanaheim from the band and the film Licorice Pizza. Well, you can get that now on BBC iPlayer, along with a whole load of other biggies like Emma, Tinker, Taylor, Soldier Spy, Loving, and Pan's Labyrinth. Now, after a marathon 14-year legal saga, the WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange is a free man, back in his native Australia. After reaching a deal with the US authorities for his release, he pled guilty to a single felony charge under the Espionage Act. WikiLeaks, which has published thousands of classified documents, has been dividing opinion for years. Now, to his supporters, Julian Assange is a valiant campaigner for truth. To his critics, he's a publicity seeker who thinks, you know, people think he's endangered lies by putting a mass of sensitive information into the public domain. So what role then does whistleblowing play in society, and how can information sharing be balanced with that duty of care? Well, that's what we'll be discussing this morning with Rabbi Pete Thomas, Tobias, Rihanna Pegado and Stuart Kelly. Brianna, do you remember this story? Do you remember hearing it at the time?
I certainly do, Zara. And I think for me, what is really significant about this story and this time is that I was in Washington, D.C. when Julian Assange released all of this kind of confidential documentation. I grew up in a community of diplomats, of politicians. My mom worked for the Clinton administration. And I remember very vividly the conversation around this being, okay, yes, you know, whistleblowing has taken place. Yes, these kind of confidential documents have been leaked. What is the value of these? And also, all of these discussions about the security of the people involved that were in compromising situations, that were in different countries. And I just remember this being an absolute explosion kind of within the political community in Washington, D.C., but more widely, kind of stepping back to what you said earlier. And I'm really curious to hear the other contributors on the call, is this question of duty of care. You know, what is appropriate to share? What needs to be brought to light in terms of abuse of power? And also, what happens to the people involved that are involved in the fallout?
And I guess how you share that information as well. Obviously, it was a global story at the time, and it has continued to be a global story since. So it was interesting to hear what was going on on the other side of the pond for yourself in your life. But Rabbi Pete Tobias, let's come to you. What were your thoughts, memories, reflections from that first reveal of WikiLeaks?
Yeah, it's a kind of a mixed bag, isn't it? Because it's information that if it's concealed, then there's a sense we have a right to know what's going on. If there is that level of secrecy and that level of abuse that's taken place that no one has shed a light on, then we kind of have a right to know about it. But then obviously there's the fallout, as you said, of the people whose lives are put in danger once the information is out there. It just shows what a complex world we live in, and our other topics are going to show us the same thing. But it's a very difficult line to walk. But I think if all of the information that was exposed by WikiLeaks had remained hidden and secret, I don't know would the world be a safer place? Probably not. Would we be less suspicious of government? Probably not. It's just kind of told us things that we already know and exposed us to dangers that were already there, I think.
That's an interesting take on it. Stuart, I want to ask you about your reaction then to hearing about Assange's release. Do you think it was fair for him to be released this way? Do you think his time has been served?
I would like to get into the legalities of it. Obviously, they've made that decision, and that is the law, and it's been observed. I think the thing which is difficult is the idea that he's somehow a patron saint of journalism. In many ways, we should be comparing it to things like the Panama Papers and with Edward Snowden. I don't detect, and certainly reading Andrew Hagan's rather excellent book about Assange, that this was a huge moral imperative driving it. He was a technocrat that was showing what could be done. And in terms of the journalistic ethics, it was actually the fact, we see it even more so with the Panama Papers, of ordinary people who were sifting through the data and finding out actually what is true, what is the material that we should know about here. So the idea that he's some sort of modern paladin, I am sceptical about, but certainly we have a right to know, and certainly the legwork of actually finding out what is important in the material that was released is of prime importance.
Brianna, does the motivation behind whistleblowing and exposing wrongdoing, does it matter?
Of course it does. And I think when we're talking about abuses of power and we're talking about things being concealed, this fine line between what needs to be kept confidential because it's, you know, government matters, because it needs to be kept in confidence for certain reasons, can be used as a cover and a justification for covering up how power is being misused. And I think when it comes down to it, there are whistleblowers that we can look back on throughout history. We can look back to biblical texts. We can look back to so many different examples of people that have brought this truth to light. And I know that this question of truth, when we live in the modern day, fake news, you know, gets to be something that gets really deconstructed. But always the kind of motivation of the whistleblower is important. What have they seen? What have they witnessed? What injustice have they kind of witnessed and felt needs to be addressed? And back to this whole question of the law and how the law has been served or observed, this is a kind of a key question to explore. But oftentimes the motivations of the whistleblower are not something that everyone will consent to or agree to, or people feel they're being held to account in a way that they don't like or is unfair. But, you know, those motivations are key.
I mean, Stuart, we heard about whistleblowing previously in organisations and, you know, lots of whistleblowers, you know, they have to think carefully about, you know, highlighting perceived wrong things that they encounter and be wary of the damage that that might cause. But, you know, do you think that when you're whistleblowing on, does it matter where the whistleblowing is happening? If it's within your organisation about perhaps a boss or somebody you know, or it's on a much bigger scale?
That's very problematic, and I can only really speak for the Church of Scotland in terms of the fact that it has really looked at what safeguarding might mean. Mm-hmm. And it does raise certain issues which might be problematic. One of the rules that we tend to go by is, if you think it's wrong, mention it. Now, on the other hand, that could just be a license for tittle-tattle and gossip, and could be quite hurtful to some people. So it's a very fine line, and I think one thing that will come again and again in this is that it shows that we need a much more subtle and much more sophisticated way of reading these situations. There are no easy black hats, white hats to point at and say, oh, this is obviously wrong, this is obviously right. Mm-hmm. So it is very difficult. I mean, from personal experience, my mum spoke out and spoke to the newspapers about the ways in which the council was cutting the cleaning in the special needs unit of the school where she was the assistant head teacher. And that caused a lot of grief. She was told on the QT, don't expect ever to be promoted for having done this. Mm. There was very much a sense of a murta. It was okay to speak within the organisation. It was not okay to speak to the press.
Yes. And so then I want to come to maybe look at this in faith in particular, because it's, I mean, your mum was probably, Stuart, your mum was probably described as being very brave at the time, and it's, I think, any whistleblower. Well, I'm sure that she was, you know, because the repercussions are obviously something that you would think of as a whistleblower, you know, whether it's going to impact your life, and really there's that sort of short-term pain for long-term gain element that you have to approach it with. But Rabbi Pete, I wanted to ask you in particular, you know, how vital is whistleblowing in faith institutions, and what does faith actually say about whistleblowing?
Yeah, it's a tough one as well, isn't it? Because the whole thing is so ambiguous, as we've already highlighted in the things we've said. It's a double-edged sword. It can bring, it can shed light into dark places, but it can also cause harm to some people who are maybe affected as a consequence, even the whistleblower themselves. And in terms of faith, it comes down to an issue of conscience, I suppose, that if you discover something that you feel needs to be brought to the attention of whatever authorities it might be, then it's a kind of an internal struggle. So do you put yourself in danger to reveal the horrors that you've uncovered? Do you suppress them and suffer with that conscience of not speaking up? It's an internal struggle, and then as Stuart said, then it becomes a kind of an external one when other authorities and other agents get involved. Mm-hmm. But I think in the end, one has to be true to oneself, and if you're carrying around a secret, and it makes you feel uncomfortable, then ultimately you need to make that. It's your own decision between you and whatever your understanding of God is, and however that manifests in your own conscience.
Mm-hmm. But Brianna, not everyone is as able to whistleblow as others. There's a to talk to us a little bit about this, about the fairness and equality there.
Completely. I mean, you know, we can't talk about whistleblowing without talking about power. And we can't talk about power without talking about institutions, without people in positions of power. And often a whistleblower is coming from a position of less power. And I know it's not always this binary, but has this information that allows them to kind of come forward and confront power that is really being, you know, abused or misused. And I have been in situations where I've whistleblown more than once within organizations in my career. All within different sectors in Scotland. And actually, you know, the impact of it is massive on the individual, particularly if you're marginalized, particularly if you are a person of color or kind of a woman or a different gender. And I think actually when we talk about the implications, sometimes the injustice is so egregious or so obvious that actually saying nothing about it ends up harming you in the longer term. But yes, when we think about whistleblowers who have been part of movements, you know, the gay liberation movement, the women's liberation movement that, you know, took place particularly in the 70s and 90s across Scotland, across the UK, people felt that actually either whether or not it was legislation, whether or not it was other people in power, that, you know, their basic dignity, their humanity, their rights were being completely you know, oppressed or kind of, you know, reduced. So they felt they had to. And actually, that's how we've seen serious change happen in history.
It's really interesting looking at those power dynamics that exist. Brianna Pegado and Stuart Kelly, Rabbi Pete Tobias, thank you all so much for that conversation. There's plenty more to come, including a look at how faith values can interact with cancel culture on the back of the new ITV drama, Douglas is Cancelled. First, this from Joni.
A parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swinging hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paid paradise, put up a parking lot. They took all the trees, put them in a tree museum. Charge the people a dollar and a half just to see them. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot. Hey, farmer, farmer, put away the DDT now. Give me spots on my apples, or leave me the birds and the bees. Seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone. They pay paradise, put up a parking lot. Late last night, I heard the screen door slam, and a big yellow taxi took away my old man. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot. I said, don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot. They pay paradise, put up a parking lot.
And Big Yellow Taxi. And if you're a fan of Joni's, check out a great interview with biographer Anne Powers on Friday's afternoon show about her new book, Travelling on the Path of Joni Mitchell. Just search BBC Sounds. Now, in the United States, Louisiana has just passed legislation requiring the Ten Commandments be displayed in large, easily readable font in every public school classroom. It's being challenged legally, with some claiming it's unconstitutional. But are the Ten Commandments still relevant in modern life? Well, Rabbi Pete, Stuart and Brianna are still with me to discuss. So, first question to all of you. Does anyone actually know them off by heart? Oh, Pete?
Yeah. Probably. Yes. I can do them in the original Hebrew if you want. Well, that's probably not a waste of everyone's time.
Oh, you're just showing off now. Go on, give us a taste.
Right. I am the Eternal One, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. You shall have no gods before me. Do not take my name in vain. Observe or keep the Sabbath. And I won't give you the full shtick on that one. Honour your parents. Do not kill. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not lie. And do not covet. Do I get a gold star?
I think you do. Bear false witness to your neighbour. Yes.
Yeah, that's lying.
Yeah. Oh, So we have the Ten Commandments. No gods before me. You shall not make idols. You shall not take the name of the Lord, your God, in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honour your father, your mother. You shall not murder, as you mentioned. You shall not commit adultery, steal, bear false witness to your neighbour, or you shall not covet. So, I mean, 10 out of 10, I would say, for you, wasn't
Thank
it?
You.
I just thought I'd run through them again, just so that we were all clear.
Sure.
Just so that we were all clear on what they
Can
were.
Can we do the 660 bits spot now as well?
Well, Stuart, let's get on to what these commandments actually mean. First, the idea that, you know, all public classrooms from kindergarten and state-funded universities shall be required to display them. What do you make of that?
Well, I think there is a problem about it being unconstitutional. There is a separation between church and state in the United States. That it could be displayed, I don't have a problem with, as long as it's not the only thing that's displayed. And we should then question if there are other things that are being displayed that might be considered contemporary commandments that other people might have problems with themselves.
Mm-hmm.
One school that I was in recently had a big thing saying, you can be whatever you want to be. And I thought, nice idea, not true. with the best will in the world, I am never going to be a great rugby player. And wanting it is never going to change that. So my basic line is, it's unconstitutional. If they want to have it up, it shouldn't be the only thing up. And there are other things which are contemporary commandments that we might want to consider as well, and whether they're appropriate.
Brianna, I'd like to have your reaction on the back of that very matter-of-fact response. Thank you very much for that. But also, just because, I mean, obviously, Brianna, you grew up in the US, and it'd be great to hear your perspective about faith in classrooms.
Yeah, well, thank you, Rabbi, because I think that was an important contribution. And I should say, I was baptised Catholic, raised Protestant, and I went to an Episcopal school for a portion of my elementary school days. And, you know, this whole question of separation between church and state, there is a separation between church and state for good reason. You know, we, especially in the United States, but also in Scotland, live in a multicultural society. People come from many different backgrounds, creeds, faiths. So this notion that you would have to kind of see these Ten Commandments, the question for me is, what is the intention behind displaying them?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if you're in a kind of independent school that is a religious school, then sure, of course, those can be displayed if that's part of your education. If you're in a class where you're doing religious studies or comparative religion, fine. But, you know, at the schools that I went to, and I, you know, having to say the Lord's Prayer in the morning and the Pledge of Allegiance was just part of our morning routine, but that was something we opted into.
Yes.
It was a choice, we consented to it. And I think this real question of what is the state of Louisiana's legislature intending to say that Christianity is the religion that, you know, is preferable or something that people have to somehow kind of show reverence to. Obviously, I think that, you know, religious kind of faith backgrounds need to be completely respected. There's so many kind of similarities and important kind of overlaps between the Abrahamic religions. But also, what is this actually saying is my question.
Well, so that's an interesting point, because I was maybe moving on to the, is it a reminder of morals, and let's maybe move into modern day morals. But actually what you're suggesting there is far more rigid, in that they are, you know, what if this is a move to simply establish Christianity as the dominant faith, and really what that might potentially lead to. What are your thoughts on that, Rabbi Pete?
Well, it's interesting that they're being sort of highlighted as part of the Christian faith, because also originally they're Jewish, so they come from there. But let's not dwell on that one. I think that as symbolically, I think what they do, if you look at, and we have in my synagogue a kind of a little stone thing which is shaped like the Ten Commandments, the two tablets of stone with just the first letter of each of the commandments on it. And I think it's symbolically, I think it shows that the importance and the need, importance of and need for some kind of legal structure in order to hold society together.
Mm-hmm.
Whether the Ten Commandments as they exist actually are the basis of what we need to hold our society together in the 21st century, I think is another question altogether. They may have worked 3,500 years ago when they were first put together.
Yeah.
But we've moved on. I mean, there are certain things in there that, yes, they're important, but they're not exactly going to change the world or make the world the better place that religion purports to want it to be. I mean, there's no mention of kindness, there's no mention of looking after the environment. They're quite narrow in their perspective. And as Stuart alluded to before, when there are 600 plus other Commandments knocking around in the same document from which the Ten Commandments emerged. So they're just kind of a starting point and a stepping stone. And as I say, I think just a symbol and represents the need that human beings have, that human societies have for legal structures. And the argument as to what those legal structures should be is that obviously going to be an ongoing one that's going to change as society and the world changes.
So, OK, so Stuart, Rabbi Pete there saying that, you know, their modern-day morals essentially is what is required, that we need to rethink them. Do you agree? And if so, what kind of modern-day morals would you like to see included in the Ten Commandments?
I think trying to get the Ten right to begin with might be a start. And yes, obviously there's far more moral rules. I mean, if we go to the Christian side of it, you know, it gets boiled down further to love your neighbour and love your enemy, as the great G.K. Chesterton said, usually because of the same people. I think that we've got to be careful with it, because the first four commandments are theological. They're about our relationship with God. The fifth, about parents, straddles between the two of them. Then the last ones are about ethics and morals, and not all of them are actually illegal. Mm-hmm. Adultery isn't illegal in this country, although certain people have held high office of states might have been not such a problem if it had been made illegal. It's not illegal to covet. In fact, some political parties actively encourage us to be covetous. So the difference between morality and legality and the theological virtues is quite complex. And I like that. I like that it's not just do X, Y, Z and you're fine. It's think about these things. Even something like keeping the Sabbath holy, which obviously in Scotland there's been quite a lot of contention about. I think we can agree, even if you're atheists, that having some time which is outside of the getting world is a good thing.
Well, that's an interesting one, isn't it? Thinking about the day of Sabbath, the day of rest, in a time, a day and age where we're always talking about overworking and, you know, being very stressed out with modern day life and there's never any end. Brianna, you're nodding away.
Well, I think as well, thinking about this whole notion of kind of morality and legal frameworks and what guidance do we need to live a life kind of in the right way, and I say right kind of not in its kind of, you know, necessarily traditional sense, but thinking about kind of Buddhist practices, what is this way of kind of respect? And I think these kind of questions of the Ten Commandments maybe not explicitly nodding to kind of environmentalism or supporting kind of our climate and supporting each other in ways that maybe are a little bit more kind of modern. I think that in principle the Ten Commandments kind of really do speak to some really basic principles that are really important and key. And also, I think if we look back to kind of earlier wisdom traditions and faith, we look back to Indigenous communities, if you look back to particularly in Scotland, kind of pagan rituals, obviously there's a lot that we could critique about these kind of different ways of living. And also I think there's a lot of really beautiful examples of communal decision making, of sharing, of looking after the planet, of looking after our environment that come kind of before the Ten Commandments that obviously kind of spoke to what was happening at the time when the Ten Commandments kind of came into being and were prophesied, for lack of a better word. Excuse me. But I think that, you know, there are so many lessons we have from different aspects of our humanity, different aspects of our traditions that speak to what values might look like today and how we want to live our life in alignment with values and how we not only coexist with one another, but thrive and support one another in a modern society that maybe isn't becoming more complex. But I think the kind of public discussion of more complex views of different ways of living and being might be more mainstream in a way that they might not have been in the past.
Gosh, well, this has been a very interesting discussion, hasn't it, about updating really those Ten Commandments or what they would include today and whether they still have relevance. I'm sure listeners will be wondering what they would like to see in there. Certainly the environment, after the conversations we've had earlier in the programme, seems like a very pressing issue that might be in there to respect the nature and the land. Who knows? But thank you very much to Stuart Kelly, Rabbi Pete Tobias and Brianna Pagado. And we have one more discussion left, inspired by a new ITV drama, Douglas is Cancelled. But first, here's the new single from...
¶¶ Mrs. Kiadu got into an accident and couldn't come to school. But when he finally came back, his hair had turned from black into bright white. He said that it was from when the cousin smashed his soul. This girl who wouldn't go and change with the girls in the change room, and when they finally made her, they saw birthmarks all over her body. She couldn't quite explain it, they'd always just
Love Island, what's a wicked show. Get lots of famous people on that none of us really know. Some bird who had a footballer, some fella from the jungle. If they want real celebrities, get Zippy, George and Bungle. The Chris Moyle Show.
Dominic goes, oh, do you know what? I'll have the same.
Yeah, I'm playing golf today. I can burn the calories. I'll have it.
And then Pepper went, do you know what? I'll have the same as well.
Yeah.
And then...
we all went in.
Captain Crapbeard, instead of having a bacon bagel with a sausage on the side, what have you opted for?
I've got porridge today.
Oh, boring.
It is a bit of a snore fest, isn't it?
Yeah.
I like porridge.
No one likes porridge apart from... The Three Bears.
Yeah.
And Goldilocks.
A few more events left at the East Nuke Festival this week in Fife. You can find out more information on their website. But here's something from a local. It's King Cruise.
Cool your lips,
It's a buzz phrase of the 21st century, cancel culture, this idea that someone shares an opinion or action that's deemed unacceptable and is ostracised for it, particularly on social media. And it's something being explored in a new ITV series, Douglas is Cancelled, which sees Hugh Bonneville playing a news anchor who finds himself in the middle of a scandal as a tweet announces an allegedly sexist joke that he has made. Now, Hugh mentioned in an interview that this idea of cancel culture is as old as the Bible. We'll come to scapegoats in a little bit, but it's an apt one for our panel, obviously, to discuss. Before we get into this, let's just hear a little clip from the programme.
That's all for today. Same time tomorrow?
Why not? See you at 6.
And that's us off air.
Oh, well, I think you've got chemistry.
Excuse me?
You and him on telly. You've got chemistry.
She adores you, you know that. Everyone knows that.
Sorry, what?
There's been a tweet.
What tweet?
Overheard presenter Douglas Bellows making an extremely sexist joke at a wedding.
Dad, what was the joke at the wedding?
I don't remember.
But it's probably just one of your usual ones, yeah?
My usual ones.
Your usual misogynist ones.
It was sexist, not misogynist. This isn't news.
It's going to be news. It's you.
She plays you.
Madeline's not like that. Is she?
It's gone nuclear.
The tweet.
What happened?
Madeline.
Oh, what did Madeline do? Well, that was the trailer of Douglas is Cancelled there, and the first episode went out on Thursday. Now, my panel today are Rabbi Pete Tobias, Brianna Pagado, and Stuart Kelly. Pete, what did you make of the first in the series?
I have to admit, I had the misfortune to watch all of it. I watched all four episodes.
Did you say
night.
Misfortune?
I did. Oh. Is that going to get me cancelled? I'm in trouble already. It sort of took me into sort of early hours of this morning by the time I'd finished it. What did I make of it? I don't know. It was kind of very witty, almost too witty. It tripped over itself with some of its lines. And in the end, the plot, I don't know if the rest of you saw it to the very end, but it gets so convoluted and complicated that it kind of ends up missing the point that I think it's trying to make, whatever point that might be. If it's specifically about cancel culture and its effects, then it kind of gets lost somewhere in the melee of different personalities mm-hmm. and their clashes, which makes for interesting drama, but it doesn't really highlight the issue that I think we're here to talk about this morning, to be honest.
Well, it pitches itself, of course, as a cancel culture drama. Brianna, does it try too hard?
I think that this series, I'm a big fan of, you know, Stephen Moffat, big fan of Hugh Bonneville and Karen Gillan. I think that it was well acted. It was a bit on the nose at times.
Yeah.
And I think that the question is, was the series really critiquing cancel culture? Were there some characters in it that were caricatures of themselves in terms of what they represented? I think from that perspective, it was highly effective. I should say, I only watched the end of series of episode 3, so Rami might have a bit more insight.
Do you want
there.
To know what happened?
Don't tell me.
Don't I'm spoil it for everyone, it. Please.
But I hear this, and I think this real question of, okay, what is cancel culture? Is it a news cycle? Yeah. Is it because of the, kind of the way we're processing information, trying to get shock value? Is this something that is genuinely causing people to be ostracized, cancelled, and is it deeply problematic? I'm curious to hear what my fellow contributors think about this, and I do think for the purpose of creating that discussion, I think the series is effective.
Oh, well, interesting. We have two conflicting views there, Stuart. Can you help us out? Is it yes or a no to this one?
No. No, I can't help out because I only watched the first episode.
Do you want to know what happened?
I'm rather Presbyterian. I think this is a self-denial. I enjoyed the first episode well enough. It struck me as being classic Stephen Moffat. You set a lot of hairs running, and if you catch one of them, it looks like you always intended to catch that hair. For me, obviously, the question is, do we ever get to hear what the joke is? I'm erring on the side that we probably don't get what the joke is. I think that would probably be wise. In terms of it as an issue, yes, it's something which has a lot of traction, and there's a lot of heat but very little light about the whole issue at the moment. I think what it boils down to me is two things. Who decides if something is offensive? And is the fact that somebody takes offence justifiable? The other thing is that we seem to have lacked in our culture now a certain degree of old-fashioned politeness. which would short-circuit a lot of these debates. I was always told when I was growing up, you know, my mum drilled this into me, before you say anything, ask yourself, is it true, is it necessary, is it kind?
Mm-hmm.
And if you can't see all three, it's probably best to keep quiet.
Well, that's interesting. It's a very sort of Rotarian perspective, isn't it, to ask yourself
these questions? There's a lot of things that people can say which are not illegal. I mean, I could go up to somebody in the street and say, those clothes look terrible on you, and by the way, you're exceptionally ugly. And the only crime committed would be incitement to violence, and the violence would be against me, and I deserve it.
Well, that's certainly one perspective, Stuart. Thank you for that. Now, I'm going to take a slight risk here in answering your question, saying that you do actually get to hear the joke at some point. So maybe that'll help people stick with it if they know that it's coming up, that you do eventually get to hear that. But moving on to cancel culture, I think it's... it's interesting to think about what that actually means, because, you know, we're saying it's been around for quite some time. Brianna, what's that term to you? What does that mean to you?
So, and I think I want to speak to something that came up just a moment ago that Stuart mentioned, this question of what causes offence. I think it's a bit deeper than that, because when we think about the term cancel culture, okay, why are we in this position now in society where people are being cancelled? What is it they're being cancelled over? And I think actually this question of kind of moving away from traditional politeness, I think that there are things that are unsaid or implied that actually signal and speak to a much wider culture, a much wider belief system. And I think this show in particular is really exploring what sexism and misogyny looks like in kind of newsrooms for a young woman who is surrounded by men that you later see on in the kind of series, actually what she kind of experiences and what she actually has to navigate. And so I think coming back to your question of cancel culture, I think what we're talking about is this whole question of what not only people can say publicly and visibly, but also what that is signalling about their deeper beliefs, potentially prejudices, potentially beliefs about other people. And, you know, I think sometimes actually kind of coming back to this point of politeness, there, you know, if you think something and you're thinking it, internally, do you need to voice it and say it out loud? And more importantly, if you do speak this and have these thoughts, what is that actually indicating about your belief systems about certain people or people from different groups and backgrounds? So I think what cancel culture is really getting at is accountability, is holding people to account for some of their views and beliefs. But I think where it gets problematic is we should be talking about how do we repair? How do we grow from that? How do we learn from each other? How do we come back together? And it sort of feels like the cycle of cancel culture is someone says something, they are maybe kind of vilified in a very public, shaming way. Mm-hmm. And actually then what happens next? We don't actually have a kind of mechanism as a society for how we repair
to bring them back
and grow from that. Yeah. It's that's the end, you're done. It's like, well, actually that's not, you know, effective. That's not fair. That's not kind. Mm-hmm. And that's not actually human.
Rabbi Pete, your thoughts?
Well, I mean, it's a double-edged, like everything we've talked about today, it has two sides to it, doesn't it? It's a double-edged sword.
We always
have
more questions than answers.
Always. I mean, but the whole thing about cancel culture, on the one hand, if it's taken to an extreme, it just creates a world of intolerance. And therefore you've had more division and more unhappiness and general inability to communicate, because I'm just not going to talk to you is not really a way to move anything forward. But on the other hand, if you sort of accept everything, then you could be opening the door to all sorts of abusive ideas and the sort of things that Brianna's talking about, those kind of mindsets that are impossible to challenge. It's just another one of those knife edges that our society is busy teetering along as we stumble through whatever the next decade holds for us.
So we can't talk about cancel culture without talking about forgiveness, which, you know, I want to ask you about, Stuart, in terms of your stance on forgiveness. Do we need more forgiveness in society? What does religion tell us that we should be doing when it comes to cancel culture, essentially?
Forgiveness is an exceptionally difficult moral category. And for me, it's one of the things that utterly distinguishes Christianity and Judaism and Islam, the Abrahamic faiths, from what was happening beforehand in Greek and Roman culture, who really have no conception of those conceptions of clemency, but not of forgiveness. The thing I would say about forgiveness is it's very, very difficult. I remember a sermon from when I was a child where the minister said, you know, we've all heard the phrase, I'll forgive but I won't forget. Mm-hmm. Well, that's not really forgiveness. You know, you can't say, I'll still keep the pain and the anger. In the 18th century, there was a very good sense about what resentment meant and the importance of letting go of resentment as something which will impede moral growth. And I think there are concepts that we still aren't comfortable talking about. And we're not comfortable talking about who is allowed to forgive. I mean, particularly in cases where there has been, for example, a murder. Who's allowed to forgive? Some people say that only the person who has been offended against can forgive. Does that extend to the family? It's a far more problematic thing. But unless we get it right, we are stuck in a perpetual sense of vendetta. And that is, everyone dies. You know, it's the old line that, you know, an eye for an eye means the whole country's blind.
Mm. Brianna?
I was thinking about some examples we do have from, you know, wisdom traditions and kind of indigenous communities around forgiveness that I think predate some of what we're talking about now. So my family is descended from Haluasaponi Indians on the east coast of the United States. My dad's side of the family is Angolan, and there's lots of kind of tribal traditions in Angola. And actually, if we look to these indigenous communities, when someone did err in the community or do wrong, you know, there was a rehabilitation process. You'd come into a circle, into a tribal council, they would err what happened, and actually the whole process was forgiveness, affirmations, kind of not ostracizing that person, but trying to reintegrate them back into that community or society. And I think actually when we look at so many of these kind of different indigenous communities, traditions, wisdom traditions, actually there's a long history of actually how human beings can forgive. And yes, I'm not saying that we forget, I'm not saying that they are completely absolved, but this notion that they did wrong, we can make mistakes, we can harm, because it's about harm, it's about trauma, it's about how do we reintegrate into society and communities when harm and trauma has been caused. But I think actually if we look to lots of different traditions, there are many examples of how this works, and also how we can reintegrate these ideals and ideas into a Western society. I think sometimes we forget some of these traditions.
Well, it's interesting to think about a process whereby the intervention that exists is purely as a form of reintegration rather than it being about a public shaming.
Yeah.
Because even in this show, Douglas is Cancelled, which is the kind of hook for us today that's bringing us to this conversation, you know, there is plans to have an interview. And, you know, we've seen it happen many times where celebrities or people then have to go on to programmes and essentially air their dirty laundry for us all to cast judgment. But it's primarily, I think, as a cause for viewing figures, and we've seen it happen. My goodness, Prince Andrew was probably one of the worst that we could imagine. It didn't go really as planned for anyone, but it was. But this idea of sort of the reintervention and reintegration process being aimed at forgiveness. I'm wondering what Judaism has to say about this, Rabbi. I wonder if there's something that you can talk about from a sort of from a religious perspective on forgiveness from the Jewish faiths?
It's an interesting one. I mean, one of the features of Judaism is the idea of a scapegoat that emerged in biblical times, the idea that all the Israelites would gather together just before the harvest festival of Sukkot in the autumn, which eventually became to be known as the Day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And the idea was there was everybody's sins, whatever you'd done wrong, whether everybody knew about it or they didn't know about it, all got banged on this poor goat's head. The priest puts his hands on the goat's head, dispatches the goat off into the wilderness, and the people would actually see a visual representation of everything they'd done wrong being dispatched and gone. And it was not, they didn't have to publicly admit to anything. It was a kind of a personal relationship, a personal statement between them and however they perceived God. But everything that they felt they'd done wrong disappeared into the desert and was never seen again. And there's a kind of a cleansing that takes place in a situation like that, which although it, for the scale, I don't know how the poor goat felt, well, I'm pretty sure how the poor goat felt, so they ended up falling off the end of a cliff. But it's of that visual ability to see your failings carried away and as though you can then turn around and then carry on and go back to life without those I think it's quite a powerful moment. Whether that constitutes forgiveness, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's more about forgetting. And one of the lines about the Day of Atonement, which is a few months away still, is, but one of the lines is that for sins between God, between people and God, the Day of Atonement atones. In other words, whatever you say mm-hmm. will do the trick. But for sins between human beings and other human beings, it doesn't work unless you first reconciled yourself with your fellow human being. So it's about seeking forgiveness from individuals as well as just saying sorry.
I mean, there's so much to ponder over from that discussion today, including the sacrificial goat. I'm sure there'll be a vegan option available for anyone that wants to attempt that for their sins today. Episode 2 of Douglas Is Cancelled will be on ITV at 9 p.m. this Thursday, or you can watch all 4 episodes now on ITVX. A big, big thank you to Rihanna Picado, Stuart Kelly and Rabbi Pete Tobias for your thoughts and, of course, your company this morning. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
That's
thank
all
you.
For me this week. Tony Kearney's back in the hot seat next week, and he'll be discussing more of this week's headlines with a new Faith Forum, plus more poetry. Now, next is the Sunday Show with Martin Geisler and Fiona Stalker. You have Off the Ball and Sports Sound to follow, with an evening beginning with music with Gary Innes and your requests. It is, however, the final day of Pride Month, and so we just could not resist a little bit of Diana Ross. And I hope it kicks off the day for anyone celebrating Pride in Fife and Portie.
Thank you.